In this lecture, we'll see Nusselt number correlations for internal flow other than laminar pipe flow, that is turbulent flow and other cases. Firstly, for turbulent flow, there are two famous equations which are used since very long, since 1930. The first one is called as a Dittus-Boulter equation. Dittus-Boulter equation is applicable for pipe flow where Reynolds number is greater than 10,000. And over a reasonable wide range of Prandtl number, which is 0.6 to 160. And it is also in the fully developed region where the length of the pipe is at least 10 times the diameter of the pipe. And in this case, all the properties are evaluated at the mean temperature. So the general form of Dittus-Boulter equation is the C, Re power 0.8, PR power N. Now the original expression that Dittus-Boulter derived was actually in terms of two numbers, for one for heating and other for cooling. So if heating means heat is coming from outside the pipe and heating the fluid which is going through the pipe, cooling is the other way. The hot fluid goes through the pipe and cools the surface of the pipe. Now, in this case, in the second case, it is cooling in the sense that heat is taken away by the surface from the fluid. So that is called as fluid cooling. Heating means heat is given to the fluid from the surface. That is heating. So the constants were two different things, 243 and 265. And for the exponents were 0.4 and 0.3. But later, some form of this got popularized, although this was not derived by Dittus-Boulter equation. So in most textbooks, you will see that it is 0.023 as the prefactor, which is not what Dittus and Boulter actually found from their experiments, but this some mishap in the literature got referenced as 0.023. So the history behind this is given in this nice paper by Winterton. The second equation, which is commonly used, is called the Cedar-Tate equation. Cedar-Tate equation is also looks like the Dittus-Boulter. So you have Re power 0.8, PR power 0.3. So this is instead of 0.8, 0.8 is same as 0.8, and PR power instead of 0.3, this is 1 by 3. And the prefactor is also roughly the same. However, there's additional factor for ratio of viscosities. So why is this used? So this is used in the previous case, all these properties were evaluated at the mean temperature. But if you have a situation where there is a large temperature variation between the surface and the mean, so when you have large temperature variation, the viscosity, if it also changes significantly, then you have to use this ratio of viscosities for the Nusselt number. This is also applicable for a slightly more a wider range of Prandtl number. Earlier, Dittus-Boulter was only till about 160. Now this is about 100 times bigger than that. Here, all the properties are evaluated at the mean temperature except the viscosity at the surface, which is evaluated at the surface temperature. The second case of problem that we'll be considering is case where you have non-circular tubes. So non-circular tubes means it could be something of a square cross section, or there could be some annular insert inside and so on. So in this case, you might have studied in fluid mechanics. The Reynolds number is defined in terms of a effective or a diameter or a hydraulic diameter. DEQ is called as effective diameter, and that is defined as 4 times flow area divided by wetted perimeter. So what is the flow area? Suppose we have taken a cross section here. This blue region is the region where flow can occur. So this dark region is a solid where there is no flow that can occur. So the flow area is only the blue region. It is not the entire region of this rectangle. So it is this entire region of rectangle minus this dark region. So that is the flow area. So 4 times flow area is that divided by wetted perimeter. Wetted perimeter means all the perimeter of the solids where the fluid that flows through this touches. So this, the red region marked here is the perimeter of the rectangle that is touched by the fluid. And the red region marked here is the perimeter of this dark region that is touched by the fluid. Why are we considering wetted perimeter? Because it is in this wetted perimeter that fluid and solid come into contact, and that's where you have frictional forces, and there is a shear force, the wall stress. It's called a wall shear force or a wall stress. So because all the regions that the fluid touches the solid, those are all regions where you have a shear force from the wall. So that is why you take the wetted perimeter. Okay, so 4 times flow area by wetted perimeter. So once you determine this, you can use DEQ to determine the Reynolds number. So any arbitrary geometry, most of them, the Reynolds number, this gives a reasonably good approximation. For heat transfer, it is not so accurate, but in the absence of any particular correlations for these geometries, you could use this. Except instead of using the diameter of the pipe, you use the equivalent diameter or the hydraulic diameter. The third case which we want to consider here, which is not a usual pipe flow case, is where you have micro channel flows. So micro channel or microfluidic chips or nanofluidic chips are very small channels in the range of 0.1 microns to 100 microns. So these are all part of devices that come to market today in medical diagnostics and for lab scale small synthesis and in situ synthesis and so on. So these microfluidic devices have very small dimensions. Because the flow dimensions are very small, the flow is usually laminar. You can never go to turbulent there. So the flow being laminar, one would think that we could use the laminar flow Nusselt number correlations. That can only be of limited use because as you reduce the dimension, the molecules start interacting with the wall as frequently as they interact with each other. So when the dimensions are large, this molecule will most likely collide with a neighboring molecule than with a wall. But as you reduce the dimensions, this molecule will probably collide with the wall as same frequency as this molecule colliding with another molecule. So this ratio we saw in the introductory class is defined as the mean free path. So when the mean free path is much small compared to the diameter, we have the continuum approximations of the regular fluid mechanics and equations that we have derived. However, when mean free path becomes of the same order of the diameter of the length scale of the geometry, then new effects come into picture, and that have to be taken into account. We are not going to derive this, but we'll see just the qualitative form of the Nusselt number in these cases. So the Nusselt number, again, because the flow is laminar, it takes the same form of 48 by 11. But that 48 by 11 has got a correction in the denominator, minus f. So when you go to smaller and smaller length scales, this f becomes important. So we'll see how that how much it affects in the next slide. But let's see what are the factors that influences f. So firstly, it is this ratio lambda. So f is dependent on all these parameters. First is this lambda mean free path by d. So that is one parameter. So this is dimensionless. Notice that these are all numbers. So f is dimensionless. So it is also dependent on other dimensionless parameters. So lambda fp by mfp by d is one dimensionless parameter. Alpha p and alpha t are called as momentum accommodation coefficients and thermal accommodation coefficients, P for momentum, T for thermal. So what do this denote? They denote whether the when a molecule collides with the wall, whether it is a specular reflection or a diffuse reflection. What does a specular reflection mean? For momentum, it means that if it collides with some velocity, the velocity with which it comes back, the speed will be the same. So that is called as a specular reflection. In the case of diffuse reflection, whatever velocity this collides with and whatever velocity it comes out are not correlated, but this velocity with which it comes out is a property of this surface. So for example, if the surface were moving at some constant velocity, this particle will catch that velocity from this moving wall, which happens in the case of our continuum approximations. Similarly, for the thermal condition, a specular reflection would mean that the temperature of this molecule, the random temperature of this molecule that comes here, and the random temperature of molecule that goes out will be the same. So that actually happens if it's specular collision. In the case of a diffuse reflection, what happens to the temperature? The temperature of this, of the molecule after it collides, is independent of the temperature of the molecule that came before collision. And this temperature is purely dependent on the surface temperature. And if whatever is surface temperature, that temperature will be given to this molecule. So this is again, alpha P and alpha T equal to 1 is the regular case that we have been considering, no slip, as well as the temperature of the molecules equal to the temperature of the wall. Whereas in the other extreme, it is the wall is as though not doing anything to this motion. Now let us look at qualitative behavior of this Nusselt number, which is plotted. Nusselt is equal to 48 by 11 minus F. So when F is 0, Nusselt number is 48 by 11. So this, you see that when lambda by D, which is the dimension of the mean free path divided by the dimension, when that becomes 0, this Nusselt number approaches the laminar well-known result of 48 by 11. And then we have plotted here different cases. First thing is that for when the mean free path becomes larger and larger here, this value of Nusselt number is smaller than the 48 by 11. So the 48 by 11 is the maximum, and then it keeps, as you increase lambda by D, it keeps reducing. That's number one. The second point is that if you have a diffuse reflection where alpha P and alpha T equal to 1, which is here, that has a higher Nusselt than specular reflection. So this purple line here is the specular reflection. So these are some qualitative observations that you can get from this equation. So finally, let's look at some heat transfer enhancements. So all the problems that we have seen so far was to determine the Nusselt number in different cases, that is laminar, turbulent, microchannel, non-circular cross sections, and so on. Why did we want to find the Nusselt number? Because if we found the Nusselt number, then we can optimize or adjust the temperature, flow rate, diameter, so that we can enhance the heat transfer. But it can happen that in certain cases, so usually if it's a turbulent flow, you will get a very good heat transfer. But it could also happen that you want a very good heat transfer, but for some reason, you are not able to go to turbulent flow. Suppose you want to increase the heat transfer in a laminar flow, what can you do? So these are some geometrical design modifications that are done so that the heat flow is increased even in the laminar flow. Firstly, these are called as tube inserts. So in this tube inserts, you see that some spring-like structure is inserted inside a tube. So this spring-like structure actually touches the outer wall of the tube. So both being metallic, this metallic surface also gets heated up to the same, roughly same temperature as the surface of the tube. And when you're going to pass liquid through this, the liquid now has got a larger surface area of contact. So earlier it had only this much surface area, but now all that, it is like an extended fin. So all these things are like fin kind of structure, which transports the heat from the surface to a increased surface area. The second thing is called as a twisted tape. So twisted tape is like a spiral tape, like a ribbon, which is twisted in a spiral and sent. So any fluid that goes there, goes behind this, comes this way, goes that way, and so on. So this way, even when you have laminar flow, what is happening is that the flow is not unidirectional. The flow goes up and down and up and down and so on. Because it goes up and down, it gets a very good contact with this. It goes like a perpendicular to this surface and then comes down and so on. So that's why it gets a better contact and the heat transfer is improved. The third case is that of a finned pipe. So here, if you see the cross section, there are all these protrusions that are coming. So this is like the fins we saw in conduction, the same kind of fins, but then now they are coming inside the pipe. There are also fins that could be outside, but since we are considering internal flow, let's consider only this pipe. So these are again small fins that are protruding inside the pipe, which increases the surface area just as this and increases the heat transfer. But in these both cases, you will have a severe pressure drop. But there is a third variant of this called as rib tubes, where it is ribs along the internal like this, but they don't block the flow so much, but they may not provide as much heat transfer, but they are like a compromise between pressure drop that you can get and the heat transfer that can be obtained. To summarize, Nusselt number correlations, we saw two important correlations, Dietes-Bolter and Cedar Tate, for turbulent flows. Dietes-Bolter is for a smaller range, but a simpler formula. Cedar Tate is for a larger range of Prandtl number. We also defined hydraulic diameters for non-circular cross sections, which is 4 times flow area by wetted perimeter. And for microchannel flows, because of the dimensions are small, the flow was laminar, but due to the nature of the interaction and the mean free path, the Nusselt number is always lower than the laminar Nusselt number. Thank you.